take our seats, we'll get started with our civic forum for today. My name is Jen Lemberger, and I'm a librarian here at the Central Library. If you didn't know, this is a part of a monthly series that we have with the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara. So the third Wednesday of the month at noon, though sometimes at 6 p.m. now, we have this civic forum on various topics with the League, and so it is a great event for us as community members to see what's happening in our area and get involved and be educated so that we can move forward and be the best citizens we can be. A couple of things before we get the League up here for their announcements. We have a couple of events coming up at the library that we wanted to let you know about. We are in the midst of Black History Month, and while we always try to highlight our diverse community, it is even better to be able to talk about the history and the future of our community members who don't always get the deserved limelight that they should. So one of our events this month, the last one we have for Black History Month, is our gospel music event that we're having with the Greater Hope Baptist Church. So not only will this be a live gospel concert in the main floor area of the library, it will also be a bit of a history lesson because gospel music has a vast history of importance with the Black community in the United States that we should all be aware of. But not only is there a history, it still lives within communities today and has power that we all should be sharing as well. And then next month is Women's History Month, so I thought the League would be interested in some of those events. We've partnered with Drama Dogs and Terry Ouvehand, who is a local writer and playwright, and so we have Women Who Defied the Odds. It is a dramatic play told through six monologues of six women who defied the odds at their time in history. So it's three actresses portraying two different women throughout time, and that will be on March 10th here at the Central Library from 3 to 5 p.m. So this Sunday, the 24th, at 6 p.m. for the gospel concert, and then March 10th, Sunday as well, from 3 to 5 p.m. for Women Who Defy the Odds. And as well, there are flyers in the back, so you don't even have to remember anything that I just told you, and you can pick those up on your way out. And with that, I'd like to introduce Lindsay Baker from the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara.
Thank you all for being here today. Please check your cell phones and make sure they're turned off. We would like to thank the Santa Barbara Public Library for co-sponsoring the forums with the League of Women Voters and Gary Atkins Soundman with Gary Atkins Sound Systems. Normally our forum is translated simultaneously into Spanish, but today our translator is out ill, and she will be translating in studio with SBTV at a later date, and it will then be posted on our website, lwvsantabarbara.org, where you can see it in Spanish. And as I just mentioned, this forum is being videoed by TVSV and will be available on channel 17. It is also being simultaneously run on Facebook, and then later it will be on our website. And when you go to our website, you go down to the Facebook symbol and or YouTube, the YouTube symbol, and click on that, and you'll see all our past forums that have been videotaped. If you are interested in learning more about the League of Women Voters, you can talk to Bev. She's at our table, membership table at the back of this room. I would like to thank the committee that worked to set up this forum, Gwen Luria, Wendy Reed, Mary Rose, Vijaya, our vice president and coordinator of this forum, and myself. I'd like to also thank Suzanne Brothen and Bonnie Jensen, our hospitality people, providing water for you at the back of the room. We will have questions and answers at the end. And I would like to mention that we will be having the forum in March on the census. Also, our league has small discussion groups, and we have added a new discussion group on Fridays. The next one will be March 22nd. We haven't had the February one yet. The February 22nd one, it's at noon at Cafe Stella, and anyone's welcome to join that at 11:30. Okay. So I would like to now introduce our moderator. Today we're going to have two moderators, and our first moderator is Gwen Maria, and she will introduce the next moderator, who will introduce our speakers. Thank you.
Thank you. Lindsay, there's a whole Luria family in Santa Barbara who are going to look at this and say, she's not part of our family. So my name is Gwen Lurie. I would love to be part of their family, but I'm not. So this is the year of the woman and Steve. I want to thank the League of Women Voters for doing these forums and giving us the opportunity to talk about some of our society's most important issues. Today, we are here to talk about Santa Barbara's foster youth and ask the question, are we providing what they need? 3 years ago, I was appointed by our Board of Supervisors to participate in what was called the Child Welfare Safety Net Task Force. It's a mouthful. The task force was tasked with examining the systems that are in place to protect Santa Barbara County's most vulnerable children and ensure that these systems were performing at their highest levels. Our guiding principle was that no child in our county should be allowed to fall between the cracks, as it is every child's right to have a safe, healthy, happy home from which to thrive, succeed, and prosper. At the time, there were just shy of 500 children in the foster care system, and our mission was to hear from as many of the system stakeholders as possible, to make recommendations to the county based on our research on how we could do better. When I made our task force's presentation to the Board of Supervisors, I was approached by Vijaya Jamalamadaka, and I promise that name, that I practiced saying that name many times. from the League of Women Voters, about making our work on the task force and the subject matter on which we focused a subject for a League of Women Voters forum. So today we're here to do that. Vijaya felt strongly, as I do and I know all our panelists do, that this is a topic that needs to be at the forefront of our community's heart and mind, because the health and success of a community can in many ways be measured by how we take care of our most vulnerable citizens. So today we ask some important questions like, how do we support people whose struggles many of us can't possibly understand? As we look across systems, to also ask, what are we doing and what more can we do to make sure that all families have the support they need to overcome trauma? Our moderator for today's forum, as Vijaya said, is Wendy Reed, who is an attorney with local and state experience in foster care and education advocacy. Wendy is also my co-chair for Santa Barbara Human Rights Watch and one of the smartest people I know. And I know a lot of people. On our panel today, we have an embarrassment of riches. We really do. We are lucky. We live in an amazing community, and there are so many people who make it their life's work to take care of our children, and this is just a small sample of those stakeholders and people who do this good work. So our panelists today include, and I'll start on this end, I numbered them, so I'm going to go back and forth my page, Kim Colby Davis, Began volunteering for CASA of Santa Barbara County in 2006 as an advocate for children. Soon after, she joined the CASA staff in the role of recruiting and outreach coordinator. At the end of her first year of CASA, the number of new volunteers increased by 53%, and the number of children served increased by nearly 65%. In 2009, Kim accepted the position of Executive Director for CASA of Santa Barbara County and has led the team to achieve growth that has allowed CASA to serve 95% of the children in need in Santa Barbara County. With a team of 15 CASA staff, they now lead a volunteer force of more than 300 community volunteers. And I believe that another statistic that she didn't put on her resume is that she asks 100% of the people she meets if they're interested in being a CASA. Amy Krieger, with whom I had the pleasure and the honor of working on our task force, is the Adult and Children's Services Director for the Santa Barbara County Department of Social Services. She has had a variety of positions in the agency where she has served for the past 20 years. Including Child Welfare Services Operations Manager and Program Manager for the Department's Foster Care Licensing, Resource Family Approval, and Adoption and Permanency Programs. And Amy was also the deputy before she became the director. Oh, I just promoted Amy. She's actually the deputy director. Okay. Someone's fact-checking me. Suzanne Grimacy, with whom I've also had the honor of working on our task force, MFT, Chief Quality Care and Strategy Officer for the Department of Behavioral Wellness. Suzanne began her work with at-risk youth in the Santa Barbara County community in 1991. She has worked with the County of Santa Barbara Department of Behavioral Wellness, formerly named Alcohol, Drug, and Mental Health Services, for 21 years, primarily in leadership roles. She serves as the Public Information Officer for the department, PIO is what they call her, if you heard that acronym today. She serves on public information team for the county in Santa Barbara, provides countywide community trauma response and disaster mental health work, critical incident debriefings for first responders, and is responsible for leadership of the Office of Quality Care and Strategy Management with Behavioral Wellness.
I did that backwards, didn't I?
I did. I was supposed to. Okay. Next, we have Lillian Hypersberg, who is a Santa Barbara native. Lillian is a retired probation officer who spent several years managing and living at the county's, only foster care emergency shelter and has herself fostered over 200 kids. Which is quite a statistic I love saying. That's amazing. And finally, So, this didn't work. I had this system that was so brilliant, and then it just completely fell apart. Dr. Steve Ellison. is CEO of CASA Pacifica Centers for Children and Families, a multi-service nonprofit agency focusing on children and youth with serious emotional and behavioral challenges and their families. Under his leadership, since 1994, when CASA Pacifica opened its doors, operations have expanded from serving 300 children exclusively on the Camarillo campus to serving annually over 2,500 Santa Barbara and Ventura County children and families in their homes and communities. Ellison has encouraged program innovation and excellence, and CASA Pacifica has received state and national recognition, including the Exemplary Program of the Year Award at the annual Conference of California Mental Health Advocates for Children and Youth. Ellison has published a number of papers, articles, and has been active in public policy efforts benefiting children in foster care and other public service systems. And finally, today, we are lucky to have everyone, but this woman flew in from Sacramento, and she is our state ombudsman. And I'm who has an MSW, Rochelle Trachtenberg, who's sitting at the end of the table, is a former foster youth appointed to serve as the California Foster Care Ombudsman. She is responsible for educating foster youth and caregivers about their rights, investigating complaints to the care, placement, and services of youth in foster care, and providing policy recommendations on improving California's child welfare system. Rochelle previously served as the lead youth organizer of the Humboldt County Transition Age Youth Collaboration, where she received national recognition for her work acting as a leader and expert for engaging system-involved youth to bring their voices and experiences into policy setting and decision-making tables at local, state, and national venues. Rochelle believes that programs, policy, and systems function more effectively when decisions are informed and connected to the real-life experiences and voices of those who receive or depend on those services. And Rochelle, you're living proof of that. Rochelle previously served on the Board of Directors for the California Mental Health Advocates for Children and Youth and is currently a member of the California Child Welfare Council and is a total slacker. Okay, so now I want to invite Wendy up to begin the panel conversation.
Hello, everybody. How's that? Good. Hello, everybody. First of all, I'd just like to echo my thanks to everybody that's here, particularly our incredible panelists. But I also have to say that there are a lot of people that aren't here today that are really important partners in this system of care that we have for our children. Missing our incredible judges, Art Garcia and Jean Dandona, people from schools. There are great programs that we have here in this community, from Guardian Scholars at UCSB and City College, to Foster Youth Services with the County Head Office. I'm going to miss a lot of people, but let me just say too that there are more incredible nonprofits that are serving foster youth, from Angels Foster Care to CALM, Fostering Friends, and so on and so on. So please forgive us. We wish we had 25 seats up here so that you could hear from everybody. And we also have Judy Osterhage here, who's, what's your exact title, Judy?
Foster and Kinship Care Education Coordinator at Santa Barbara City College.
Santa Barbara City College Foster Care and Everything Else Coordinator. So thanks for being here, Judy. Again, we wish we had a lot of seats because one of the things we really wanted to do today was just give everybody a sort of general idea of who our foster kids are and how we can help provide even more support for them, and also how we can help social services and some of our county departments do the incredible job that they do. So, you know, people often used to ask me why I became so passionate about foster youth, and it's a longer story that includes me getting matched up with a little foster kid. When I was 20 years old, I volunteered with a little boy who was 6 years old at the time, and he's almost 40 now, and I've stayed in touch with him and followed his path, and that's really been my education into foster care. But I went to law school because I was really struck with the idea that I think that we have a moral responsibility to help children and families who need help. But I think that with foster youth, you know, we elect the judge that sits on the bench and says to a family, you're not doing a very good job of raising your child right now, and so we're going to remove your children from you, and we'll take care of them while you hopefully get the services you need to heal. And in that moment, that judge makes us the parents. So I've often felt that we not only have a moral obligation, but we have a legal obligation to help foster kids. I've said this for years. In fact, some of my friends on the panel have heard me say this probably one too many times, but I have to say that over the last few months in particular, I've begun to expand that view a little bit, and it was really sort of instigated by me reading this report that was put out in August. The Public Policy Institute of California, the PPIC, put out a report about poverty, and I was absolutely shocked to see that Santa Barbara County
Well, I should just read it. It said that according to the Public Policy Institute of California report, 26.3% of all children in Santa Barbara County live below the poverty line. So this is the third highest rate in the state of California. We're topped only by Los Angeles County at 27.8% and Santa Cruz County by 27.2%. And while we're often quick to point out that housing and employment are big factors or the only factors, I thought one of the most interesting pieces of this report was that poverty rates are closely correlated to education levels. It went on to say that more than half the children and families without an adult who completed high school, so that's 53%, live in poverty. So this compares with just 8% of kids in a family with at least one adult with a college degree. So while I will repeat my belief that we have this moral and legal obligation to help foster youth, I think that we in Santa Barbara County have this incredible opportunity to say, who are all of our children in need? Why? What causes a child to be removed from their families and put in foster care? And are some of those precipitating problems things that we as a community can help social services and mental health and all of these wonderful people up here, can we help them do their job even more effectively? So, having said that, as I said, we really wanted to have sort of a light touch today where we could give a general overview of kids in foster care. And so I love numbers, and I love websites that dump lots of numbers on you. So I was tempted for a brief moment to just dump lots of numbers on you. And then Gwen told me I couldn't do that. So what I decided to do instead was really just hit the highlights. And one of the most incredible data points for us here in Santa Barbara is when she was chairing this task force, there were about 500 children in foster care. So that was the piece that I decided to look up. And I thought it was very interesting that in July of 2009, so almost 10 years ago, we had 594 children in care. That number has gone down significantly, so much so that in July of 2018, we had 280 children in care. So that's less than half, if I have my numbers right. That's an incredible achievement by our county in really trying to attack this problem of not bringing children into foster care. We know that kids do better if we can do all we can to help keep them in their homes and families. However, it also sort of raises a couple of questions. Why have our numbers gone down? Are there little red flags that we should look for that would be indicative that we could direct some more attention and energy into other areas? So I told the panelists that I have four questions for them, which I will present in order. And then afterwards, we will leave it open for questions. And I think we've scheduled about half an hour for questions, although I do have to say that Suzanne Grimacy has to leave 15 minutes early. So if you have any questions for Suzanne, try to get those in first. So that will be at about 1:45 that Suzanne is leaving. But the rest of us can stay and ask any questions you want. And it's again, we're very lucky to have all these people here, so please use them. Wring them dry of questions, any information that you may have. So there were questions about our format. Do I ask the questions and make everybody go down and nobody else can say a word before the next question is asked? I said that I would just go about it quite casually and just see if somebody else wanted to pipe up and talk, then we'd allow them to. I say that, but I'm also warning all of you that if we can't get through the questions, I will interrupt you and stop you and make you go back to the beginning. So with that, our first question is that, as I just said, we've had a pretty dramatic decline in the number of foster youth in care over the past 4 years, 5 years, really 10 years. I'd be curious to know why each of you, what you attribute this to. What do you think the decline in numbers can be credited to? And are there any data points that you think we should be aware of as a community that might make us, might serve as a little red flag? So Kim, would you like to tackle that first?
Well, I thought we were going to be random. But sure, I'll tackle that. I'm going to speak from my perspective, and others are probably going to have different or better statistics than what I have. But as the leader of CASA, one of the great things about growing to this place where we're serving almost every single child that the court asks us to, what I've seen over the years, and it's been about 12 years that I've been with CASA, I see much more effort being made to keep the child with the family or with extended family. So what I don't see is, I don't see a dramatic decrease in the total number of children who are in the child welfare system, because I still expect that we'll serve 500 kids this year. So, but we serve children who aren't just in foster care, but who may have been removed from their family and then reunited to the family. And we serve children who have been removed, and maybe they're with a family member. We have a lot of grandparents raising kids. We have aunts and uncles and other family members stepping up. And so that may, in my view at least, I'm kind of looking over to Amy because I'm like, oh boy, I'm out on a limb here. But that's what we see at CASA, is it's not so much that there's less children. What I would equate it to is, we haven't seen tremendous population growth in the county in 5 years or so.
Right.
And so I wouldn't have expected to see a dramatic growth in the number of children, but rather there's been a very concentrated switch to trying to do everything that we can to keep the children in their families or as close to their families as they can be. And so maybe that has switched a little bit of those numbers. And I think what's important, I think a key aspect for me, is when we talk about children in foster care, this is a big conversation with CASA programs, not just locally, but nationally. When we talk about children in foster care, people understand that, but we serve children who are in foster homes, but we serve all of the other children who the court has said need to have that advocacy. And so there's a big difference there. And so I think part of what we all have to get our heads around is, what are we talking about when we talk about foster care? Are we talking about only children who are in out-of-home, out-of-family placement, or are we talking about all children who have suffered neglect or abuse?
Thank you. And Steve, before you go, I just want to say that we've been talking for the last 24 hours or so about all these numbers and data points, and I did want to tell you that there are a couple of great websites if you're interested in diving deep. One of them is what I call the Berkeley website. It's not the right thing to call it. It's actually the Child Welfare Indicators Project, and it's Child Welfare Services actually feeds the data. Every county is responsible for feeding their data into this website, and it's very complicated, very deep dive possibilities if you really like the numbers. The other is that Child Welfare Services actually has a great website that has some links to data as well, and I also pulled some information from the California Child and Family Services Review, the 2017 county self-assessment, that was really interesting as well. And just to Kim's point, we actually, Gwen and I were looking at some of the numbers this morning, and we were surprised to see that actually the child population in the county of Santa Barbara has stayed remarkably stable over the last 8 years. I thought it had gone up or gone down, but it's really pretty much the same. So just so you know, that's kind of a baseline according to the data sources that we looked at. Okay, Steve.
So I think a big change has been the number of services that are delivered in the home or in the community for kids who are in the child welfare system or on the verge of being removed from home. Some of those have been a function of lawsuits, class action lawsuits filed here in California. There are a couple of important cases. One is called Emily Q. lawsuit, which really brought about a behavioral intervention in home, and the intent of that lawsuit was to assure that kids who were receiving mental health services actually had access to in-home services that would function as sort of augment whatever services they were already getting. That that service has made, I think, a big difference in enabling kids in the child welfare system to remain at home with their families. Second one is wraparound. That's another service that's not a litigated service, but it is a service that really came out of Chicago, is now pretty much nationwide. It's called Wraparound. And the philosophy of that service is whatever it takes to keep kids and families together. That includes a flex fund that providers who offer wraparound can use to support families in ways that are pretty non-traditional, helping them pay a month's rent so they can stay where they're currently living as they're getting back on their feet, or really whatever. There are a number of other community-based services which I think have had a dramatic impact on enabling kids to stay at home with families and keep them out of placement in a foster home or in a group home or in some kind of institutional care. Those are a couple just to touch on.
Great. Suzanne.
I think we don't know the answer to this. I think it's likely that there are a lot of factors that have contributed, and they're all good ones. Another perspective to offer that I've seen CWS do and continue to do well and expand more and more over the years is to offer voluntary services to families before it becomes a mandate of the court, as Wendy was describing. And as humans, I think we're far more likely to want to engage with other people and engage in services when we have some control over that than when it's made a mandate. So the CWS really doing such a good job in expanding that offering of voluntary services, I think has made an incredible difference.
Thank you. I will agree with pretty much everything that's been said here so far, and especially the point that there's just a lot of factors, I think, that are driving this change. So for child welfare, back to numbers, I just want to kind of put into context that I think, you know, if we look back to 2000 and, did you say seven? Is that what the number you quoted?
2009.
Yeah. We had the methamphetamine epidemic back around 2006, and so really that 2006 to 2009 time period was kind of the height of the number of children that we have seen in foster care. It was much lower previous to that. So since that time, you know, there's a tremendous amount of work that was done in our county from a lot of the agencies, the county agencies and all of the partners to try and get their arms around that and see what could be done to help stem that epidemic, and so we've seen the decline since that time in the number of youth in foster care. In addition, there has been really that concerted effort to really look at prevention and early intervention and really recognizing that children do best with their families and that we want to do everything we can possibly do to keep them there as long as they can be safe. So I would just say a couple other contributing factors have been the advent of safety and risk tools that were not previously available to us back then. There's been a lot of work at the state level, and all of the counties are now using evidence-based safety and risk assessments, which allow us really to get a better idea of, you know, is a child safe in the home, and what is the risk of future maltreatment if we were to leave them there. So that's allowed us really to kind of focus our interventions much more effectively and really rely on foster care only as the last possible step when there's no other way to work with the family, either voluntarily or to get services in the home with some kind of a safety plan to bring in families' support networks. And so because of that, I think we are really relying on foster care much less than we did 10 years ago as an intervention.
Great. Lillian, if I can interrupt just for 1 second, because Amy, I just wanted to follow up on one thing. The methamphetamine problem I know was certainly at a peak then, but I don't think I'm alone in having this sense that drugs are a big problem in our communities right now, and particularly the opioid crisis. And I know that is affecting our families, but I'm kind of encouraged to think that if one of your points is that the methamphetamine numbers were high and we've dropped down because that's not a problem any longer, does that mean that that opioid problem has not stepped in and replaced that? Or how do you think that drugs are affecting those numbers now?
I would just say that certainly substance abuse is one of the primary drivers of children into foster care still.
Yeah.
And the opioid epidemic is certainly a huge issue. We have not seen it to the levels in child welfare that we did with the methamphetamine epidemic. And
okay.
I think Suzanne could probably speak more just to the general countywide statistics.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, we might be able to come back to that, but let's finish this round. And Lillian.
I would say some of the contributing factors have been the changes in laws. For example, the Community Care Reform Act. The way that we're working with children and families is significantly different, whereas Amy and some of the other panelists indicated that we're working with families at the front end rather than waiting until they're so engrossed in the system that they can't recover from that. Another thing is that the children who have experienced a lot of trauma in life, we're discovering those issues even at elementary school levels. So we're able to undergird those families and work with them from the beginning. The other thing is the Resource Family Approval Program, which allows a person or a family to be approved not only to be a foster parent, but to also be a guardian and an adoptive family simultaneously, rather than going through each step separately, which allows children to be in a permanent placement almost immediately, because they can be, the foster parent can be there and it can, months or maybe a year later, can even have access to adopt the child if they're available for adoption.
Michelle.
Thanks. I think I concur with everything that has been said. There's been lots of legal changes that have happened. Structured decision making is this tool that is being used in child welfare to better assess, as was said. Same thing with this concept of safety organized practice. How do we keep families safe in their home? How do we keep children safe? What are the resources to help families do that? Also, differential response and early intervention opportunities. So really, the first contact with child welfare, giving families the opportunity to access services and resources. I think one of the things to consider is the 0 to 5 population is the most at risk for neglect. And so the home, when nurses go, nurse family partnership is what it's called in many places, where nurses go into the home with first-time moms to help them adjust to having a new baby and all of the things that go with that. I think also this understanding of how trauma impacts children's development is something that's been kind of on the national front, and certainly here in California. I think all the people at the table today can talk about how the understanding of trauma has changed how we do business in child welfare and the experiences of adverse childhood experiences. So I think all of this information has really changed our practice. And I think the decline in numbers also reflects some of the economic changes in the last 10 years. So we talked about drugs and methamphetamine use 10 years ago. We were at, you know, the beginning of a major recession then. I think we'll see that pattern happen over time. As we have economic recessions, we'll see higher substance use rates, and then more kids come into care. And I think as we're looking at the opiate epidemic across the country, it's something that I think all child welfare directors are really going to struggle with, and behavioral health directors, and also providers, because we have to work with children who've been substance exposed, families who are struggling with substance use, and there's a general lack of substance use treatment for families across the country. So all of that, I think, has contributed to how the numbers have changed. So I think the fact that numbers have gone down in Santa Barbara County is a good thing. We know that kids often do better in their long-term outcomes when they're with families. So that's what I would add.
Thank you. You know, I also want to mention that Gwen mentioned that Rochelle is a former foster youth and doing this great work on the state level, but she's also a foster parent. So I think that's pretty impressive to be a social worker, foster parent, coming from, yeah, so my hat is off to you. Our next question, we toyed around with a little bit. It ended up being, what would you say is your biggest challenge in meeting the needs of foster youth that you work with? One of the versions of this question was, how can we as a community help you do your work? So perhaps you can kind of merge them together and tell us, what do you find most challenging about your work, and is there anything that you can think of that we as a community can help you with? Let's just go down the line again. Why don't we try that?
Okay. Well,
the model that CASA uses is that we work through the community. So we're completely dependent on the community because we have a tiny staff that's backed by 300 plus volunteers. So without the community stepping up to volunteer, we can't provide the advocacy that we provide for all those children. But I will say one of the challenges that we have, we're very, very fortunate that in Santa Barbara City right now, we have more CASA volunteers than we have children. And so that's a great place to be. But what we've also seen, or at least what I have seen over the last 10 years, is the growth in the need in the North County. So we have intentionally been focusing our recruiting of volunteers to Santa Maria and Lompoc, where our greatest need, right now Lompoc kind of exploded a bit, and all of a sudden I need many, many more volunteers in Lompoc. So that's a constant challenge for us, to find the community where the children are, because it is an absolute wonderful thing that I have volunteers in Santa Barbara that will drive to Lompoc or even to Santa Maria, but that's not the most efficient use of time. And so it is a constant challenge to get the word out. So, you know, what can the community do? Certainly act as ambassadors, and I found that people know people everywhere, and just spreading the word that there's a need and opportunity. I think of CASA as that community opportunity to, instead of sitting on the sidelines, sort of complaining about a system or wondering why it doesn't work, it's the opportunity to get your feet in and be part of a solution. And I think everybody has that opportunity to engage in some way. So that's one way. And if I can bounce back, and maybe we can circle back, one of the things, going to this conversation about drugs, when we are working with the children and their families, we're seeing drugs as a core problem in probably 80% of them. I think any conversation that we have around foster care has to include what are the root causes. I don't think that there is a bunch of people in our community who are mean and intend to neglect or abuse their children. And in fact, you know, I think if you look at some of the protective factors that have been put in prevention, you can see great success. But, and somebody along the line said this, is maybe we're lacking in the resources to fight addictions, because sometimes the addictions are so strong that then the parent who otherwise or does love their children, but otherwise could care for that child, addictions are very strong. And if we're not supporting that, I mean, if we were just to knock out that, I think we'd have a really different conversation around foster care. So I think it's a worthwhile conversation for us to have.
Steve.
So, yeah, I think I'd agree that a huge challenge for us is drugs and families and kids even who are involved with drugs of some kind. We have a campus in Camarillo, and we serve probably 600 kids over the course of a year on that campus. We also have staff up here, which I'll mention in a second. But in surveying the youth about drugs and their exposure to drugs, or themselves being being users, substance use abusers, really, 90% of the kids that we have in our programs on that campus in residential, which is the highest level for foster youth, have drug histories of some kind, either in their families by their parents, one of the big reasons for removal from home, and them coming into foster care, or them using themselves. In Santa Barbara County, we have about 60 staff split between Santa Maria and Santa Barbara, North County and South County. We operate four different programs. A huge challenge for us is staffing, especially licensed mental health staff. So that's a constant churn. Staff come to us and are interested in collecting hours, so they can get licensed, and then we'll move on. So I would say finding a good quality staff to be able to operate our programs is a real challenge. I think we are fairly successful in meeting that challenge, but it is a constant struggle, especially bilingual staff. Finding bilingual staff who have solid clinical training and can provide the services that the kids and families that we treat need. So I think I'll leave it there. We have other challenges, but we can circle back.
So we spoke about the number of children in the foster care system decreasing, and different reasons for that. I think it's likely then that those that are still, or the numbers of kids that are in the foster care system, are likely those with the greatest or highest level of need. We also spoke collectively to the least restrictive setting, so living in the community being the most ideal. I think one of the greatest challenges, we have a lot of resources, but I think we can do better, and I think we need more to be able to keep kids here in the community while they are in the foster care setting, getting those resources. Foster family agencies, therapeutic foster homes, there's been a lot of tries over the years to grow that number, to keep kids here, and to grow those resources, but Santa Barbara has a high cost of living, and it's hard. It presents a lot of challenges for families and settings that would add to that library of resources here.
I would agree with all of those challenges as well. Staffing is certainly an issue for our agency, and Cost Pacific is not alone. I think that's a pretty common refrain from all of our partners in terms of having qualified practitioners who are able to meet the needs of the children and families. I would say for child welfare, our primary challenge is on having enough resource families in our community. And we've made tremendous strides, both as a county and in partnership with our FFAs, in recruitment. We've increased the number of new homes we've recruited approximately 300% in the last 3 years. So we've made a lot of strides in that area. But unfortunately, the children who are in foster care, who are the most difficult to serve, those who have experienced the most trauma, are the ones that it's the most challenging to find a home that's able to meet the needs of that child. And so that's really where we continue to struggle. We have plenty of homes for young children, plenty of homes to adopt, but we don't have a lot of homes available to take high needs kids, older kids, sibling groups. And so that's an area where we're constantly struggling.
And for me as a resource parent, I find my biggest struggle is the slow assessment process and slow delivery of services. And it's because of what we said down the road here, is we don't have the qualified people remaining in Santa Barbara County. They come to our beautiful universities, they gain up all the information, but then they need to move on because they can't afford to reside here. So that's my biggest struggle, is not getting my children enough services in a timely fashion.
I would concur with everything that's been said. One of the things that's happening across the state is we've made this change to move away from putting kids in congregate care facilities or institutional care with this desire to really have them in foster homes and in their communities. But that is really difficult to do. And there's new expectations and training requirements for caregivers. It's put a burden on the child welfare system. It's put a burden on existing foster parents. And really it's hard, I think, to get people to take the kids who need homes, and those are primarily children between the ages of 10 and 18. And that's when we see the most placement disruption, so they start moving homes. Once you start moving homes, that number increases, your outcomes get worse. So we really need people who are dedicated and committed to being foster parents, but in order for them to do that, they need constant support. So if any of you have raised children, I want you to think for a moment, who did you turn to when things were difficult? If you don't have children and you have pets, who do you turn to when things are difficult? And what do you do when you are facing something that challenges you in taking care? And so I think that that's the same thing that caregivers struggle with. I think that we really need a lot more intensive therapeutic foster homes, but that is a full-time job for a parent. And it also requires full-time, 24-hour, around-the-clock support from all of the agencies that are represented here at the table. The other thing that I think that we've talked about in terms of what are some of the struggles and how do we address it is, I think we have to think again about the community and trauma. You know, all of the programs that are up here have this idea of trauma-informed care or addressing trauma. And all of the research shows that that people who are substance using or substance abusing have the highest rates of trauma. So Bessel van der Kolk and Gabor Mate are two researchers who've done a lot of work at looking at the correlations between substance use and trauma. And so I think we have to ask ourselves as a community, what are we doing to prevent trauma or address trauma, whether we live in the North County or the South County? How do we as a collective community come together around this idea of preventing trauma and treating trauma? And I think that it comes down to, you know, good clinical care. I know that that's a challenge. It comes to having support networks and communities of people you can turn to in hard times. And when we're talking about families involved in the child welfare system, again, we're talking about the most marginalized, the most disenfranchised. They don't have a single person to pick up the phone and call. And that's when things get difficult, and then we find them at the door of child welfare. And so I think if we want to be preventative, we have to really think about how do we rethink what community looks like, and how do we address trauma.
Thank you. So I asked this a little bit the first time, but I'd love to ask you all again. I mean, the specific question is, what can the Santa Barbara community give you to make your work more effective? So you've really sort of answered that question to a large extent. I know, Kim, you're talking about more volunteers in those communities where the need is. But I'd love to go down the panel again and just say, you know, I often think that sometimes problems are so big that and foster care seems like one of those problems. I can't be a foster parent right now, and if we're talking about resource families and that's how it's defined, you're either a foster parent or there's really not much we can do. You know, can you think of ways that you know, we can walk out of here and think, well, that's something I can do. I can help be an ambassador for CASA, or I can help lobby my county supervisors to make sure they know that we feel strongly that these kinds of programs should be fully supported. I mean, I guess I'm leaning more towards the people that are working for county departments, but can anybody want to volunteer to tackle that question?
Well, I'll tackle it again in saying that I recognize not everybody can volunteer. It's not always the right time in somebody's life, and we recognize that. So the other kind of obvious, it's obvious to me, challenge for most nonprofits is we start our year at zero, and then we have to raise the money to run the organization to provide the services to the community, right? So that is a way that everybody can engage at whatever level that you're comfortable with and with whatever agency you decide you're comfortable with. But I think investing into the nonprofit agencies that are getting the work done that's critical and important to you, I think you can't really underestimate that value, because we've tried now for 5 years to come up with an idea or some magic solution to the problem that would just fund CASA forever, so that we weren't constantly having a gala event and trying to get people in a room to ask them for money. Look, it's really hard that we're dependent on foundations and individuals and some government money, but we have to kind of throw it all out there in order to do the work. And I think where the community can come in is say, you know, where's my passion? And I can't be a volunteer right now, but I can support this agency that's doing the work that I think is so critical. And by doing that, now you're being part of the solution.
So volunteering your time or volunteering your cash?
Perfect. That couldn't have said that better, yeah. Wendy, thanks. And really, I'm saying that for all
right.
Nonprofits. It's
right.
About where's your passion and where do you see the work getting done?
Right. Steve, you right there with the volunteers and cash part?
Well, ditto. Yeah. I think I heard a presenter on YouTube talking about what is your why. You know, so what we're talking about here is what we do, how we intervene. But the real important question is why do you do what you do, and what really is your commitment to certainly this work, which is caring about kids and families. And yeah, we need, you know, actually it was Pipersburg, Lillian, yeah, I think it was your husband. We talked about, we had a kind of a reception where we were talking about our services, and we invited the Pipersburgs to come and talk about their experience. They have foster kids, and we have services that support foster parents, certainly in some cases, support the kids that are with foster parents. And it was great to hear, I think it was your husband, who said about our services, wraparound in TBS, which I already mentioned, that it felt like that the services that they were getting for a specific child who was in their home, it was like the Verizon team, if you remember that old commercial, that there was all these supports that were there. And I think from a nonprofit point of view, that's what we would love to feel like, is that there's the Verizon team right there with us and behind us, supporting the work that we do.
So I work for the county, so I'm not going to ask for volunteers or money, but what I will say is that I have seen, that before I answer the question, I have seen this community, I've seen the players at this table for decades now be incredibly creative to meet the individualized needs of kids in the foster care system, or with nine toes going that direction to keep them from entering. And that creativity has gone a long, long way. But I still go back to individualized resources, individualized services that are in place already to meet the needs of kids and families. And what I mean by that is I don't think our community has right now a robust continuum of care. If you think of the physical healthcare setting and of a hospital, somebody might go to one level of care, their needs increase, they go up, their needs increase, they go up. Specialized care, they go over, needs increase, they go down, until the needs have gone down. If we want to keep our children here in the community, we need to have a full existing continuum of care available in our community. So I spoke earlier to, I think we all did, to the availability of resources for kids to live. So more foster family agencies that can afford to live here, to house children with that level of need. How we make that happen, I'm not sure. There's probably a variety of ways. But I think if I look at what's missing in our continuum, I think thinking of it as a continuum, looking at the gaps and what's missing, and I think the keeping our kids housing-wise with the right services and supports for them to live here is probably the main missing piece.
Thank you. I would agree with that as well. I think, as Suzanne said earlier, there are a tremendous number of services available, but there are gaps, and there is a need really to fill out that continuum and have the types of child-centered, trauma-focused services available regardless of what the need is. So that is a big need. In terms of supporting, if you can't be a resource parent, and of course we realize not everyone is going to be able to be a resource parent, you can partner with a resource family and provide respite. You can support them in other ways. Lillian can probably speak better to this than I can in terms of, providing social supports, bringing over meals, helping just with everyday kinds of childcare, babysitting, or just being somebody to call. The other way that you can support children in foster care, there's all the agencies here. There's a lot of other agencies in the network in our community that need support. And one of the things I bring up periodically when I'm asked is the ability to provide kind of normalcy for children in foster care. Things that we are not able to use our child welfare dollars for, like trips to Disneyland. And again, there are a lot of efforts being made by certain agencies in these areas. You know, we work with CASA very closely to help provide these types of experiences, especially around holidays. We end up getting a lot of donations, which again, thank you, CASA, and other partner agencies for. But the rest of the year, you know, people need cheerleading outfits, they need football gear, they need science camp trips, they need all those types of things. And so we're always going back to being creative, as Suzanne mentioned. And a lot of times when push comes to shove, we can make that work. You know, we can get out there and find somebody who will support that need. But other counties do have, you know, auxiliaries or other, you know, community-based foundations or organizations that come together and provide that support year-round, where a family just has to ask, and it's not where, you know, we need to come together across multiple agencies for every request and figure out how are we going to make this work. So that's a very concrete thing, I think, that, you know, that our community could help with.
Okay. First of all, I would like to present my big ticket items. So the big ticket items would certainly be for transitional youth, the benefit of having affordable housing. I know we do have some programs here, but certainly not enough to cover all of our youth transitioning out of the foster care system. Adequate employment, mental health services, plus a environment, a safe social environment where these youngsters can hang out. They don't need to be at nightclubs or in the corners drinking or anything. They need to be in environments that are safe for them and they can have a good social life. With younger children, certainly child care services, after school programs that are free rather than charging families hundreds of dollars for them to be on a basketball team at any club. And then also, too, for families, particularly those caring for young children, affordable child care. I mean, I recently looked into child care, and it was like $1,000 per kid. And I'm going, who can afford that? So do I make a choice to put them in child care or feed them? I mean, it's just kind of a hard setting there. So things of that nature. But as far as simple and being creative, just think within your heart what you're passionate about. Do you like sports? Do you knit, crochet, paint, color, whatever? Those services or those abilities that you have personally, you can share those with the child. So if you're a good artist, you know, invite them over, or we can set up a place where you can go and teach art, sewing, cooking, anything. Anything that's beneficial to the child and life skill services can benefit them for a lifetime. So whatever you're passionate about, share that. We can also use what we call foster grandparents. You don't necessarily have to go through the system to be a foster parent, but come along and give children exposure to a different generation on their perspectives. I mean, I used to love when my mom, I could talk to her about the Great Depression and always got A's in history. So I'm just thinking, sharing your stories with them, it's really beneficial for children. There's a program in town called Arts from the Heart, and a woman takes children into convalescent homes, and she teaches them how to appreciate and love the elderly, and the elderly appreciate and love those children. So things of that nature would be very beneficial.
I don't know that I could add anything else. I agree with the big ticket items. Yeah. I think that all of those things are get to that sort of systemic level of how do we address, you know, people who are disenfranchised and support them. I would say that I think from the perspective of having been in foster care, things that would have been beneficial to me that a system could have provided would have been this concept of the day-to-day life skills that you need to be successful as an adult. And growing up in foster care, I didn't have those opportunities. So I didn't go to a grocery store from the age of 13 to 18. And then I had to figure that out. So there's lots of ways that normal life experiences get taken away when you enter foster care. And so how do we give young people those opportunities? So I appreciated the mention of sports and extracurricular activities, of intergenerational and cross-generational mentorship, I think that education is another thing that we really need to look at. So foster youth, about 50% of foster youth don't graduate high school. And we talked about how education and poverty are tied, right? And then poverty and substance use. And so if we start looking at how do we really also support foster youth to have educational stability and educational success, that doesn't require you to be a foster parent. And I really believe that education is what helped me get out of poverty and have a life different from what my parents had. And so I think really looking at all the different ways that we can give young people in foster care the sort of normal life experiences or typical life experiences that are age and developmentally relevant are things that add protective factors over time. And everyone's already kind of mentioned different ways that those show up. And so I think finding the resources in your community that work with foster youth and supporting those organizations and agencies, or doing it yourself and offering your knowledge and expertise or mentorship is key. And I think that's not just for the kids, but for the bio families and the foster families as well. I think somehow we've gotten away as a society from seeing the humanity that everybody deserves, that everybody should be treated with empathy and compassion. And one of the great things that I appreciate about Santa Barbara is they've been part of the Quality Parenting Initiative. And it's a philosophy, it's not a program necessarily, but it's a philosophy of kind of getting to that root of everybody needs support. It teaches foster parents and bio parents to work together. It shows foster parents and bio parents that they become the community for children, and it's that community that helps that child be successful over time. We used to have this idea that once your kid was in foster care, you were a bad parent and we shouldn't engage with you, and that's not the case. Most of the parents really do care about their children, and they really do want to get them home, and they don't have a clue of how to do that. And it's a very short time frame when you have a court and a child welfare agency telling you what you need to do to get your kids back. And so I think thinking about that and thinking about how you can support these people who are in the lives of kids is really how we can be more effective at our jobs. Great.
So the last question was, in all of your travels and your professional experiences, have you come across a model? And actually, Gwen has a question to ask too, but I wanted to follow up with, you know, what you'd like to have provided with this question, because I'm standing here and I imagine that I'm not the only one who thinks, well, I can take a foster kid to, you know, an art museum, or I can do some of those things. But my question is twofold. Where do I go? Is there a place where I can go in the county to find out, you know, how to get involved, not as a foster parent, but as something a little bit less than that? And a follow-up to that is, are there programs in other counties that you've seen that manage this question really well that we could help, you know, implement here to make it easier for us to figure out how we can help you? Go ahead.
Okay, in line or out of line?
No, yeah, out of line. We're out
so,
of whack here.
In Santa Barbara County, you can go to the Santa Barbara County website, to ourcountyourkids.org, and that's a subsidiary of Child Welfare Services, and we can lead you in a direction so that you can help foster children.
And there's a list of resources or opportunities for people to help?
There's contact information.
Terrific.
There.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And we do have cards on the back table there with
Great.
All of that information for you.
Great. Okay, and so then the other part of that question is, have you seen programs in other places that you've visited where you think, wow, that's a really remarkable program, wish we had that in Santa Barbara?
So I'm happy to jump in here. That's not quite the way I was going to answer the question. So let me rephrase the question about what have we learned in the last 10 or 12 years that I think sort of has taken us to the next level in terms of programs and interventions that we can have with kids in care? Rochelle already mentioned the ACEs study, Adverse Childhood Experiences, and the impact that trauma has on the developing brain. I think we've learned a lot about the plasticity of the brain over the last decade or so. We know a lot more about the teenage brain and the way it develops, and infant and toddler brains and the way they develop and the kinds of experiences that kids need to really develop into successful adults. One of the models that we're using is called the person brain model. And it's really looking at the term of art that we use is reimbursements. What are the experiences, the kind of the key developmental experiences that kids have missed who are in the foster care system? And then how can we help them gain those experiences in a way that will lead them to a more successful life? We look at 8 different domains and see where the deficits are that the kids in our care have, and then how can we craft experiences that will help those parts of the brain develop. In addition to that, one of the international figures that we've used in our training has told us for years is that really the most effective thing you can do in working with these kids is teach them how to read to the fourth grade level. If they can read to the fourth grade level, then they have a shot at potentially an effective life. If you look at all the people in prison, kids in prison, many come out of the foster care system, they haven't learned how to read, and they've missed a lot of really critical developmental experiences that we can also figure out how to provide. So I'd say the big advances in our industry have been in the areas of neuroscience and knowledge about the developing brain and what we can do to help shape that brain.
Although I do want to interject here, Steve, that we are not only in Santa Barbara County where we tend to do things even better, but we're in the public library, so I think we can do a little better than fourth grade, right? We can get them to read to the 12th grade level. Let's do that.
Yeah, so that'd be good.
I would add there's an area I think that there might be opportunity for the community to figure for this part out. Amy mentioned that we partner at Christmas time, and that's been a wonderful opportunity to partner with a wide number of people in the community. The community literally provided thousands of dollars of Christmas gifts to every child in the system at Christmas time. And yet I still saw that there were areas of duplication. And so it just makes me curious, instead of using our resources where we're duplicating each other, in fact, that's how our partnership came to be, is like they were trying to do something, we were trying to do something, and everybody else was trying to do something. And we thought, well, what if we just work together? Could we coordinate this and organize this a little bit better? And I think there's so much will in the community to do great things for kids and, you know, provide prom dresses and cap and gown and, you know, sports, whatever you call it, everything associated with sports, and dance. All of the little girls want to dance. So I think there's a great will for that. And but there's not a really good mechanism for making it happen in an organized way. It's a little random right now. And there's an interesting website called One Simple Wish. Now, that's a national website, and you can literally put down, this is what I want for, and this is the reason why I want it. And it's focused a lot on foster care. And then other people can sign up to solve that wish. Hmm. So it's a really interesting model. But I wonder if maybe there's an opportunity to put some heads together and maybe do that on a local level. And maybe we, instead of having everybody out there trying to do their own little bit, maybe we could organize the resources. So
that's a great idea.
Opportunity.
That's a great idea. Gwen, you had some questions, right?
So one of the things, Amy and Suzanne, you'll remember, that really came out of that we talked a lot about is the dovetailing of so many of these issues, right? That how connected the foster care issue is when you talk about the inability to, you train these great people and then they leave because they can't afford to live here, so it's affordable housing. Substance abuse plays a huge role in the work you do. And I'm wondering, do you feel like the interconnectedness of all of these issues are recognized enough by our elected officials and being talked about enough in symphony with one another? Because that seems to me to be such a missing piece, that you guys are on the front lines of all your work, so you're looking so up close and you're just trying to, you know, and you're doing an amazing job of making sure you're taking care of everything that's in front of you. But I'm wondering, what could we do to be able to step back? I mean, another word, Suzanne, I think you used was creativity, and you do a great job of being creative and solving problems on the spot. But is there a way to have like a bigger creative conversation about how these issues, these critical issues, interplay with each other, and how in some ways we're working against ourselves?
Well, I'll try and touch on that. I think we have an amazing community, and I think our elected officials are aware of the many issues that we're faced as a community, adults, children, foster children, and the interconnectivity. And we can dive deeper on that, and we can learn more, and we can better understand. But I think even with that, we would still be left with, okay, so who do I call? And how do I figure out these services? And so often, someone will get a number to call because they have a connection, and they jump into a service. Is it the right one or the right place to start? I don't know. And doesn't work as well, and then you're calling someone else, and people find themselves navigating through a system which may or may not be the right path to navigate. And so the end result may be good, but are we maximizing the services and the resources that we do have together? So my response, if I were to answer models that I think are best, but I think also answers a little bit what Gwen is saying, I think a model or a program or a community that has very, very, very strong interagency, and I don't mean just county agencies, in all of our agencies, collaboration, relationships that stay strong, that you know changes together, that you know one another's resources, you start to create that continuum of care that I mentioned. So if staff come and go, still know what CWS does, still know what Casa Pacifica and Casa and down the line, and so we become one continuum of care. And if somebody calls behavioral wellness, we're not the right place to start, or we have another referral. We all speak the same mind, and we all know where to redirect people, and we work together with a strong interagency collaboration. We've seen that in our county when resources were different, and we all physically were located on the same building site. It was amazing. You could rotate and swivel chairs and figure out that stuff. That's a model that I think works best.
And have you seen that in any other county right now? I mean, I understand that we had that at one time under MISC, right?
Yeah, different counties. I don't think there's probably any county that's going to say, nah, that's not the right model. People just go about how they organize it differently. Mm-hmm. And I think sustaining it is the big piece. So we can have a summit. We can walk out of it with linked arms and that strong collaboration. How do we keep that? How do we keep it so that if somebody calls one entity, they can say, oh, you know who you need to call? I'll help you. This is who you call. So how do we keep that as robust? And I've seen different counties, you know, people drift and they come back to that.
And I would add to that, one of the things you said was, what are we missing? Mm. So I don't have an answer to what it looks like. I think there's an opportunity there as well. But I've seen several conversations now occur in our community talking about the foster youth or ACEs or just trauma for children. And more today included, where is that piece of that's addressing drug addiction, alcohol and drug addiction? And I think we're missing that. And I think that you have to get all of the partners to the table to decide what that thing is going to look like. Like, I don't know what the, I don't think we have it, and I don't know of a community that does have it. But whatever you, if you want to create something and your end goal is reducing child neglect and reducing the number of children who are in care, then you need all of the players at the table, and I think we're missing a player.
So,
You know what, we're gonna be in questions in 4 minutes.
Okay.
So Amy, why don't you take us out?
I wanna try and thread some of those things together. I think going back to the issue of prevention, that's really one of the really important pieces here, and there's a real lack of funding for primary, even secondary intervention. Our department administers those funds through the Office of Child Abuse Prevention, and I think it's less than $500,000, I believe, off the top of my head. And we have a lot of partner agencies that use that funding and provide wonderful services, but it doesn't go very far. We have family resource centers in our community that provide a lot of support to families, but again, they're small and they can't possibly serve all of the families that need, you know, that are in need of those services. We did recently have a combined child welfare stakeholders meeting with our local child abuse prevention council, which some of you here attended, and that's what we heard repeatedly is just, again, the need to kind of bridge the two worlds between prevention and child welfare and to really shore up those resources for our families. And it goes back to the substance abuse, the mental health, the lack of housing resources, and those things that do drive, you know, maltreatment of children. So I think that's a real big piece where we can definitely do better. And then as far as, you know, the big picture, I think for child welfare, we are looking at a core practice model for the state and partnering with behavioral wellness. It's our integrated core practice model, which really looks at how we do the work that we do. And as far as models that work, there's a lot of models out there. I think for child welfare, we're constantly having presentations from different counties on what they're doing that's working well for their county. We even look outside the state sometimes. But there's such a number of models out there, and they're focused on specific populations that they work for. It's really hard to like pick a model and say, oh, this is the one that's going to work. So we end up, you know, taking pieces of lots of different models, and instead of just trying all those models, what we do is we compare them against our core practice model and say, is this going to work in our county? Is this, you know, is it evidence-based? Is it trauma-focused? Is it family-centered? Is it culturally responsive? All of these things, and so that we're trying to instead of delivering all these fragmented service, just bring in all of these services that align with that model. And that gets back to like what Suzanne said as far as working together across agencies collaboratively and all of us kind of adopting these best practices and deciding what will work in our county.
Great. Well, it is now 1:30, so we would like to open it up to some questions. And again, I just want to be sensitive to the fact that Suzanne has to leave in 15 minutes. So if you know you have a question for Suzanne, go ahead and ask. But we also have somebody with a microphone that's coming. Two people with microphones that will come around.
Thank you very much for being here. Maybe I missed it, but I didn't hear very much about what part the school system plays in the development of these young people as they go through from the lower grades up to the colleges. Can someone speak a little bit about that? How do you establish relationships with the schools or as teachers and so on?
And actually, can I just interject that Susan Salcedo, who's our superintendent of county schools, really wanted to be here today and couldn't. And so Gwen and I and Rochelle met last night with, Dolores, who works with foster youth through the county Office of Education. That was really educational for us to hear how schools are coping with this issue, but thank you for asking the question. And Suzanne, can you?
Yeah, I'm happy to. I'm sure we all can answer that question, but my perspective on that, when I think of what's what are the absolute necessary components to an interagency collaboration? The schools are right there. That wouldn't even enter my mind of how do we grab them, because we do work together and we have to. I know behavioral wellness has a very close relationship, but I know others do also. Kids are at school more hours in the day than they're at home. We have to be working together very closely, and that includes ongoing day-to-day needs at all different levels, but it also includes, you've heard a lot about kids that have been impacted by trauma in the ACEs model and brain plasticity. That all falls into, we need to be there as a community with and at our schools, I believe, in response to bad things that happen to schools, and help in trauma response and in that way as well. So it goes both ways. I think that interagency collaboration couldn't possibly work without the schools being a part.
Hi.
How are the teachers involved? I'm not getting very specifics in your response.
Mm-hmm. So I can explain a little bit. Quite a few of our teachers have gone through the ACES training recently. Also, annually, we have a program called the Bridges to Resilience, which is a program that looks at the mental health and the trauma piece in children, and most of our teachers have gone through that program as well. So they're familiar with some of the information that we have as far as working with the children and their families.
And can I add on the education piece, CASA volunteers always talk with teachers. So regardless of what, even if it's preschool, they would talk with the preschool teacher and all the way up into the community colleges. So there's always that connection, and we consider teachers among our strongest connections. So they really do create a seamless connection.
So there are educational rights holders. So people in the community, volunteers, often it's a CASA, who will be working with the school district, the schools that a youth is in, and making sure that the youth has the kinds of educational supports that they need. I think for us, that's a real struggle. I know Santa Barbara County has what they call CTE classrooms. What does that stand for? Center for Therapeutic Education. Those are special education classrooms. There's certainly an overrepresentation of foster youth in those kinds of educational settings, and I think the schools do really a good job identifying the funding now. That's another state policy issue, the local LCCF, right? Local. Local, there you go, that's it. And part of that allocation to school districts is based on the number of foster kids that are in that school system. So they're kind of a special population. Bilingual is another criteria. So there certainly is a policy effort to try to address the educational needs of kids in the foster care system.
And as mandated reporters, teachers are often one of the highest source of initial reports of abuse or neglect to our child abuse hotline.
I'm hoping that somebody has an idea of who's first.
Are you here?
No. She's the boss on the questions, just so that we all know.
Okay. Oh, hi. I was interested in what you brought up, Kim, about the what I heard. The statistic I heard was maybe 80% of these families that end up in the system is the situation is related to substance abuse. But you're saying that there's a huge gap in how that's being addressed. I was just wanting to dig a little bit deeper on what you meant by that, and what's missing, and what it would look like to fill that gap.
So 80%, I would say, is like, I'm using that as a generic number. I'm basing it on looking at the number of children that we serve and the number of those cases where the underlying cause that the child was removed is that they were neglected, and that the reason they were neglected is because the parents were involved in some type of drug and alcohol abuse. There may be secondary factors like mental health or anything like that. So I am not an expert at all on drug and alcohol. I'm just reporting what I see looking at all of these kids that we're serving, and I keep seeing this common factor. And then the challenge in it, you know, you have, like, for instance, you have Calm, and they're doing great work with preventing child abuse. I think it's probably remarkable what they've done in that work. But you can't mandate somebody to participate. I don't think you can. Again, I'm not the expert. But how do you motivate a parent to get involved in a drug and alcohol recovery program? And it's a really sad thing where it might be that when their children are neglected enough, that they are no longer safe, that might be the motivating factor. And again, you know, this is just coming from, this is the constant thing I see case after case after case, and that is a significant element in so many of the children in care. Now, they might not be in foster care, they might be in relative care, or they might even be back with the family and the family struggling to recover in that way. It just seems to me like Suzanne probably can answer this better. Maybe it feels like too big of a problem for a community to tackle. I don't know. But it feels like I haven't seen enough focus put on how could we get out there, not on, we should always continue child abuse prevention, but is there a way to get out there on drug and alcohol prevention? Mm-hmm. You know, I think I see some great efforts being made addressing that with youth through the Boys and Girls Club, through Fighting Back, Santa Maria Valley, some wonderful work being done working with the kids, and yet we have the parents. And I really feel that those parents never had an intention of neglecting or abusing or subjecting their children to an unsafe situation. But yet we have that problem. And I simply don't have a solution, but I think it's something maybe the community could think of tackling, even though it seems like a huge, huge thing.
Yeah, I'd love to respond to that. And this isn't a solution, but it's a tool we have now that we didn't have in November. So not that all parents of children in the foster care system have Medi-Cal as their benefit, but many do. Prior to December, there were few alcohol and drug services that were reimbursable through Medi-Cal, or those that were for short durations of time, and that has changed. Effective December 1st in our county, we now have what is called a drug Medi-Cal organized delivery system. This is mandated throughout the state of California. But what it means is all counties must have available this full continuum of alcohol and drug services that are now reimbursable through Medi-Cal. And there's one number that people call to get authorization for those services. Part of that mandate, as one example, we could speak all day to this, in our county, in Santa Barbara County, we have not historically had residential services available except when someone is pregnant with alcohol and drug issues, because there's not reimbursement for it. This is now required, and it's reimbursable through Medi-Cal. So we, starting December 1st, when we launched our organized delivery system, we're authorizing these services to now, we're continuing to expand contracts for beds because they're being filled and they're being filled. So it shows us that people, is everyone who has an alcohol and drug need willing to accept the treatment? I don't know, probably not, but there's sure a whole lot of people. I mean, a lot. We're getting an average of about 100 calls a day now on our access line, and about 80% of them are requesting alcohol and drug services. So I don't know. We'll see the impact it makes, but it is available now.
And I do know there's a growing movement of people in child welfare services in general that believe that you know, I think it was one conference I went to that said, we don't have a foster care problem, we have a drug problem. Mm-hmm. So I think that that those ideas are beginning to infuse the flow of dollars that come to, you know, right. counties to help solve that problem.
I think funding is important related to this issue. And so having the drug Medi-Cal is certainly a benefit. But I think we also have to think creatively about what services look like to people. And if they're not alluring to them, they're not going to use them. And I think one of the things we can look at from other countries is when you have a parent that goes into treatment, that the child is living there and with that parent in that facilitated environment. I don't think the removal of the children is in and of itself going to be the motivating factor, because if their children were... when their children are removed, that's a trauma on the parent that makes it even harder than to engage in those services. So I think we have sometimes told ourselves the wrong story about what motivates people to seek treatment. Mm-hmm. And keeping families together, keeping kids in the same environment as the parent when they're seeking treatment, that's a supervised environment. And there's many models that have lots of research and success behind them. Unfortunately, our country is a little bit behind in adopting those models and using them here. There are some across the country that give treatment to the parents and the child, and they're living together in that residential setting. And I think that that's where we should really begin to look at how are we using drug Medi-Cal and other funds that we can leverage to make treatment something that is for families and keeps families together, because otherwise we keep recreating the same problem. So I just offer that as another thing to think about, is just the fact of removal because of substance use and neglect is not, and then having treatment options will not necessarily solve the problem mm-hmm. if we're not treating the family unit as a family unit.
Yes.
Is that? There we go. Okay. Well, first of all, thank you. Great panel. Very informative. Something that we've been trying to do for a while, and I haven't had a lot of success, to be quite honest, is it, I'm the CEO of the United Boys and Girls Clubs. Terrific. And we offer free programming to foster kids. So within our organization, it's specifically United Boys and Girls Clubs. So if there's a child that includes all the services that we do, so if it's need for summer care all day, that's totally scholarshiped. If they're needing, you know, participate in athletic programming that we do, totally scholarship. And that would be our Carpinteria Club, our Westside Santa Barbara Club, Goleta, Lompoc, and our Buellton location. So
terrific.
I've got business cards. If anybody has any questions on that, you can certainly get connected with me. But we're more than happy to serve those kids. Want to make sure that we get them in our facilities.
Great. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you. And just, I know that that is a resource that we're frequently putting out there. I'm sure Lillian is aware of that resource and helps share that among the resource family community as well. I think it does not extend to North County, though, and that is where the majority of the kids are. And so,
like Lompoc, right?
Lompoc. Okay.
Lompoc and Buellton.
Okay. So that's part of the, I think, the disconnect there with the numbers is that most of our kids are in Santa Maria.
My guess is, though, that there are organizations in Santa Maria that would feel the same way if we approached them and asked. Yeah.
Right. I don't think we've had quite as much success and not the generous offer that we've gotten here from your organization. So thank you.
But I'm really excited to hear about the Lompoc part of that, and we'll definitely be connecting and taking advantage of that.
Great. Yes.
Does it work?
Judy.
I'm Dr. Judy Sullivan Osterhage, and I work with the foster care system at Santa Barbara City College. So many things. I wanted to address what we do at Santa Barbara City College to support our foster youth. We have a Guardian Scholar program, which helps with books, which helps with services, which helps with tutoring, which helps with housing. It really encompasses, but offers them a space where they can be together. And we also work with our Santa Barbara Foundation, Santa Barbara City College Foundation, and working with getting services, and it's a work in progress with our youth that were survivors of sex trafficking. And so I didn't want to be remiss when we're talking about youth and foster care and how that link goes. And I also wanted to address, I work with a lot of moms in recovery homes, and not one of them I've ever worked with is not just dearly love their children. But one of the biggest things why women do go AWOL is that they don't have any contact with their kids. Mm-hmm. And so if we can train the foster parents to have some kind of contact, a Skype, I don't know what we can do to really train our foster parents more, that the connection, and we do, because that's the number one goal, is to get that connected back to the birth family. So just somehow, I don't know, because when that woman in recovery has that open, maybe an email or something with the foster parents, they do better. They do better in their sobriety and in their addiction. So, and there's a lot more. But anyway, I wanted to thank you all for being here. Oh, Amy, I wanted to thank you because you talked about prevention and you talked about services for foster parents. And the indicators that show a foster parent leaving foster care is they don't feel like they have the services. They don't feel like they have those. So I appreciate you bringing both of those up. Thank you.
Thank you, Judy.
I have heard that homeless women, there's been a big uptick in homeless women. And are you seeing their children in foster care or involving them in foster care? And if so, how is that working?
I mean, certainly homelessness is a big factor in just the family instability overall, and it can lead to children in foster care, but homelessness in and of itself is not a reason for us to have a child put in foster care. I don't have numbers, but I have not heard that there's been a big increase for us in the number of children coming into foster care because of homeless mothers, necessarily. I don't know if anybody else has anything to add.
I would echo that. CASA volunteers work with a number of families who may be homeless, but we generally don't, I would not say it's a huge number, and we definitely go along 100% what Amy said. In and of it by itself, it's not a reason for a child to be in the system, so we wouldn't even see those. There has to have been some other thing that fell apart that would have that child be involved in the system, and they may or may not be removed from the parents. But we have CASA volunteers all the time, today and every day. We would have a CASA volunteer who's assigned to a case where the family is in some state of homelessness or working their way back into a home. But I'd even go so far as to say that something this community can be really proud of is the number of resources. So in all of the kids that we see, we don't see poverty or homelessness by itself as any reason that a child would be in the system. The Child Welfare Services does a remarkable job of putting the resources around those families so that they don't come into the system. So that's not a big factor in what we see. But we might see somebody who had, not been able to protect their kids, usually some type of drug abuse, and then they're on the street, and maybe kids, fall off the radar a little bit, and then they work their way back. So we've seen children reunited to families that are living at the homeless shelter. And that is a really good step in the direction, of having that family be whole and back together. And the community does. Our community has a remarkable number of resources, so I don't see the poverty issue as the great big one that we need to solve. I feel like we do a good job putting those resources around those families.
Can I just add one more thing on that point? We don't want to underestimate the impact homelessness has on families, and it does make it certainly much more difficult for them to participate in reunifying with their children if they have been put in foster care. I mean, if you don't have a stable home, it's much more difficult to access services regularly. And it certainly is difficult on the children. It's an added layer of trauma for the children if they're homeless. It causes quite a bit of stress for them. So I don't wanna underestimate the impact it has. And I also just wanna add that we were very fortunate this year to have a partnership with our county housing authority, and we are one of five counties that were selected to participate in the family unification program. And so we received 74 vouchers this year that are available specifically to families who are participating in the child welfare system and that housing is a barrier for them reunifying or for keeping their children in their home, and also for youth who are aging out of foster care.
So that is a really exciting opportunity for us, and we are actually just this month starting to get those vouchers awarded to families.
Somebody.
Hi, thank you so much. Terrific information and work. I wondered if any of you can just mention Welcome Every Baby, which is a prevention program for a visitation at home after a baby is born, and just how that's working out now as a prevention program for child abuse. And the other thing that I wanted to ask is, would one or two of you give some grounding to us by giving us an example of a foster care child and their situation, and like over a couple years, what happens to them?
A good story?
Good or bad?
Well, I know, Steve, you've got a number of stories of kids that have come in, come through Casa Pacifica over the years. I know that some of the kids that have been at Casa Pacifica tend to view that as a home that they go back to, and you see alumni come back there. Is that right?
Yeah, we have a big alumni group that has an event every holiday season. This last year, I think we had over 200 alumni who came, and we have some really great success stories. One of our, we also hire youth advocates, so kids who have been in placement with us who are now adults, either in college or going through, you know, starting employment efforts. We have one of our shining examples is a, she's now working for Head Start in Ventura County. She got her PhD at Pepperdine, and she was with us 8th grade through about 10th grade. So she was with us for a couple of years in her growing up. There are other stories like that we have there, and then there are kids who struggle. And we had a young man who came to one of our alumni association or alumni gatherings a couple of years ago, and he had spent 10 years in state prison, and he was coming back to give back and to have he wanted an opportunity to talk with boys who were in our program to sort of tell them what it's really like and what they need to avoid to not duplicate his experience. So we do have success stories and stories of kids who also struggle. We had a young man we discharged a week ago, two weeks ago, who we placed, or the county placed, in a foster home, resource family home, and he struggled, and they decided they didn't want him after about 10 days. And so that's a real, talk about trauma, talk about being rejected, and that's going to be something that he's going to have to figure out how to live with. And his options are pretty limited. So there are, everybody has a story, and that's certainly true for kids in our kids that we serve in the foster care system.
Did anybody want to address the Welcome Every Baby part?
No, I don't have enough on that. But I served in that committee very briefly, and it was up and coming. Florine's last name? Florine Bettners was one of the lead people in that organization. She's with the County Education Office, and it was very successful. We went and taught them about community care, the Community Resilience Program, which is CRIM. It's a program that addresses trauma in children. Rather than remaining in the trauma, we give them the 6 or 7 steps to move out of that and how to carry their lives in a more proper fashion. So we were teaching the nurses that were teaching the parents. But with respect to children in foster care, I have amazing stories, a lot of stories. And as he mentioned, that some of them are good and some of them didn't turn out so good. But one of my most proudest stories is I had a sibling group, a young boy and a sister, that came to me some time ago. And the boy was very studious. He always did his homework, never ever any problem. The girl was very brilliant, but she was always interested in so many different things. Well, probably about a year and a half ago, he called me to let me know he was getting married. And he had gone through City College on AB 12, which gave him some finances to assist him with college. He went on to San Diego State University, and now he's in Florida going to veterinarian school. Oh. And I go, whoa, what a neat story. So I constantly get pictures of him on Facebook, and the wife is just absolutely beautiful. He brought her to visit me, and she calls me mom, so that makes me really proud. And then his sister, on the other hand, came and brought her fiance to meet me, and I won't say too much about that guy, but, but you know, so she's moving through life, okay, but you know, I'm very proud of both of them for sustaining themselves after the fact that their parents both passed away from substance use. And I have a girl that I do share in common with, Casa Pacifica, who's been a dear heart for me in my life for many years, and I still get calls from her. Mom, I'm not doing good. Mom, I'm doing great. I'm not doing good. So it sort of fluctuates. But she's a dear heart. I speak to her frequently. And with respect to the Boys and Girls Club, you all have been very helpful to me and the children that I've had in Santa Barbara. My kids go. They play basketball, football, whatever's being offered. And then to Dr. Orshahe, with respect to support to foster families and resource parents, we have started a version of a program that's called the Mockingbird Society. However, ours is called the Villages. And so we're surrounding resource parents with support within their community. So we have four village homes that are established now. And they do support one another. They can help each other out with respite care, social events, and other activities for the children. So that's something that's new. We started that maybe a couple of months ago.
And is Welcome Every Baby still in effect in the county?
Yes, I believe it is.
Yes, okay. It is.
And okay.
I think CALM administers it, or at least they're very active with it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it's a collaborative. There's a number of parts to that program, but it is a prevention program,
yeah.
And it is, you know, evidence-based. Home visitation, nurse-family partnerships are both evidence-based approaches, and it is a, you know, an important program in our community for prevention.
You know, we have come to the end of our time, and so I did not, if it's from you, Gwen. What would you like to ask?
Can I ask one quick question?
Yes, please do.
So this woman over here brought up school rightly, because obviously kids spend a lot of their life in school. And I know that there are certain laws regarding confidentiality that are put in place to protect kids, but it can also be an obstacle to people who are working with kids to understand their needs and where they've been. And so where are we at with that issue? I mean, are those rules that are put in place, are they helping? Are they obstacles to what kids need? What is the...
We'd like you to answer in 5 seconds.
Okay. I would not say that confidentiality is a barrier with the schools. A teacher can, or another educational representative can be a part of a child and family team, and we can share information as it pertains to the child and their educational, you know, stability and success.
Unfortunately, with court-appointed special advocates, we report to the court and we work under the direction of the court, and we are held to really high levels of confidentiality. So we do have some restrictions. A lot of our supporters want to meet the kids, and that's not an option. You know, you really do have to go through the training and the swearing-in process to be a CASA to work with one of our kids.
So you mean people come to you and say that they want to meet the kids before they've been
gone through the
training program?
People who are
right.
donors, or people who, I want to buy
right.
this or that, but
right.
I want to meet the child.
And CASA has a really terrific and very rigorous training program to learn the laws and the rules and all of the systems that are in place to support that child. So point well taken. It's an important responsibility to become a CASA. And I'd like to recruit you on behalf of Kim to become
Thank
a CASA.
Thank you very much for doing my job for me. Appreciate that.
Okay, so we have come to a close. Let me just say thank you again to all of you. Really appreciate it. There are some materials on the back table, but please feel free to come up and get information from the panelists themselves and continue to ask questions to help support our foster youth. Thank you.